Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Just got through praying, talking to the Lord, listening to the Lord. Let me just say that. We have to listen to the Lord. You know, lots of times people, they think that praying is petitioning the Lord. They don't know there's different kinds of prayers. And, you know, you can do all these studies about prayers. I recommend, well, I studied this stuff on faith before. Dad Hagen, they call him Kenneth Hagen, the one who's passed away, not his son who's still alive. The father, he didn't wear glasses. The son, his same name, Kenneth Hagen, he wears glasses. The son is still alive. The father, I recommend his teaching, especially about faith, and he's done lots of good teaching about prayer. But I would say that it's so simply stated that to prayer is to commune with God, to hear from God, to talk to God, to converse with Him. So how do you get to know someone? How do you get to know somebody? By talking to them, spending time with them, them talking to you and you talking to them. So that's what I noticed the biggest problem about people when they're having problems getting a hold of God, hearing from God. It's because they're doing all the talking. So I advise you to wait on the Lord. The Bible says those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. You know, they'll mount up as wings of eagles. They will run and not walk, you know, and they will not grow weary. That's from Isaiah chapter 42. Those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. So wait on the Lord, I say. Wait on the Lord. He will be the one to make a way for you. He is the deliverer. He is the redeemer. He is the savior. Just while I was praying, the Lord had spoke a little word to me. And he said, you know, we talked about the churches, and the Lord, as I've told you, as now this is the third video I've mentioned it, and as many days, the Lord spoke to me and said that he wants me to make a video, and he gave me the title first, an indictment of the Laodicean church. The Lord has an indictment, which you get from Revelation. That's the Lord's, you know, comments to the seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. And this is the indictment that the Lord has against the end times church. And so the Lord spoke to me tonight and said, this is what he wants me to say right now in this video. And the question is, why do you seek the living amongst the dead? For he is not here. He is risen. And the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, the angels told that to Mary Magdalene and these, you know, the women who had come to the grave. Early in the morning, on the first day of the week, on Sunday morning, for those who just put that out there, what the Bible tells us, if you read the Gospels, I believe it's particularly Matthew and John, put them all together, you will see that it was the first day of the week, Sunday morning, when the Lord Jesus Christ was resurrected. Those women did not go Saturday night to the tomb. You couldn't prepare the, you know, the body of a dead person in the middle of the night. They got there just before dawn, it says, on the first day of the week. And while they were almost there, there was an earthquake because the angel of the Lord came down and rolled the stone away from the entrance so that people could see that the tomb was empty. The Lord was resurrected at the moment of that earthquake. He came up and left the grave. And then the angel of the Lord rolled the stone away. He didn't need to roll the stone away for the Lord to walk out. The Lord was already gone. The angel of the Lord rolled away, that mighty angels rolled away the stone so that the people could see the disciples and those women that came there, Mary Magdalene and the others, to see that Jesus was no longer there, but he was risen. That's why, as it tells us in Revelation, the Lord's Day, which is Sunday, the first day of the week, we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. And is a sign that we are under the new covenant, the New Testament, the Lord's Day. The day that our Lord rose out of the grave, Sunday morning, early in the morning. That's why lots of churches have that, you know, Easter sunrise service. Because the Lord rose there just prior to sunrise on Sunday morning. As a matter of fact, according to following the pattern of God from the creation, there was night first and then day. That's why in the Jewish holidays, the day begins at sundown. So the Sabbath of the Old Testament ended at basically 6 p.m. on Saturday night. And of course, the Bible says early in the morning on the first day of the week, as it started to dawn on the first day of the week. So you're talking 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning on Sunday morning, the first day of the week. And of course, no one would go out when it was dark, 6 o'clock at night, at dusk is when the first day of the week began, on Saturday night, and go to the grave. You wouldn't go there in the middle of the night to a graveyard. Nobody does that, you know, and it's just not proper. It's not right. Nobody does that. Not even about superstition, but nobody does that. Anyhow, you can't see what you're doing, especially then, you know, with a torch, you know, some kind of lights and stuff, torch or something. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I've just got onto that as the Lord led me, but what I'm trying to get at is I just covered all that ground because, you know, when people watch a video, they'll say, well, you know, amen, Brother Patrick, don't let those Judaizers get under your skin and all that. No, 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 brothers and sisters, no, 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 no. Every part of the video, as someone, of anybody who's making it, who's being led by the Holy Spirit, there's parts of the video for you and parts of the videos for somebody else. You know, there's a word in there for somebody. And there's many people, not just somebody, but lots of people who've almost under the bondage or the yoke of the Judaizers. And when I say Judaizer, what's a Judaizer? A Judaizer is someone who believes that Gentiles supposed to follow the law of Moses, where the Bible clearly teaches all throughout the New Testament. The whole debate was there was all these Jews trying to put Gentiles under the law. That's the whole debate and discussed throughout the New Testament, culminating the best and easiest way to see, to cut right through that, clearly written out, Acts chapter 15. They had a meeting in Jerusalem and said, hey, what do we do about this? And the answer came that it seemed good to the leaders, the half-brother of Jesus, who was the head of the church in Jerusalem, James, and Peter, and Paul, and all those guys, and all the leaders there in Jerusalem, the elders and the other apostles, they said it seems good to us and to the Holy Spirit, you know, that you don't have to be circumcised and follow the law. Read about it, Acts chapter 15. But that's why I talked about that. And then when I use the expression shallow end of the pool, I think I mentioned this in a video. I want to mention this again because one person messaged me and said, you know, I was talking about baby Christians. No, I believe I already said this in a video. If not, I'll say it again. When I say the expression for those in the shallow end of the pool, there are people that's been Christians. I have a relative that's 88 years old that's been a Christian for 81 years. Who believes that the gifts of the Spirit and all that was only for the life of the apostles. And I know I mentioned this in the video the other day, but I'll mention it again in case you didn't see it. This person's been a Christian 81 years and they're still in the shallow end of the pool. And it's not about being a new Christian. When I became a new Christian, and lots of people I know who are new Christians, they're hungering and thirsting for the deep things of God. And they dive right into the deep end and they don't have no problem. You know, the only thing they need to do is be careful to read the Word to make sure that, you know, and listen to the Holy Spirit, the leading of the Holy Spirit, that they're not getting pulled into some kind of a wacky doctrine. There are people who dive into the deep end of the pool and just throw the Bible out the window. Next thing you know, they start saying that because a fly landed on Obama's face, that makes him Lord of the Flies, Beelzebub, therefore, you know, he's the Antichrist. All these non-biblical, nonsensical divination babbling. When people are trying to come to the conclusion something about God or even about who's the Antichrist from all these non-biblical sources, that's a form of divination. The only source we should be using, of course, is the Word and the Spirit. Not all this nonsense of reading tea leaves and looking at hieroglyphics and all this stuff that's from satanic and demonically inspired sources. This is divination 101. This is ancient tarot cards written in stone that do not have the message of God, but the message of the devil. And even if some of the message of the devil turns out to be true, even if we say, oh, the devil's plan is to do A, B, and C because he put it on the back of the dollar bill, which is true, the Great Seal of the United States and all that about building the new Atlantis and the new world order and all that junk, that's just the enemy's plans. But the enemy can do nothing unless God allows it. So this is all half-truths. That's what I mentioned in the last video that I just loaded. And I want to talk about it right now. The video I made 3 days ago that I just loaded. 50 Shades of Gray. The devil has 1,000 shades of gray. And that's what's wrong with YouTube. And the Lord, you know, just giving it to me, and I'm just, you know, inspired by Him and running with it. To, you know, that's the way the, you know, the thing about, I thank the Lord that the thing that the Lord is doing with me, particularly in my videos, is these one-liners, you know, that's like, says, you know, that just boils it down to the simplest way for everyone to understand it. The devil has 1,000 shades of gray. And that's what we're dealing with all of this nonsense on YouTube, is all these shades of gray. And so, that's on the YouTube. But in the church, in the churches, there's 1,000 shades of gray again. And that's what the Lord has called me out to do in these last days, before the rapture, before the tribulation, is to tell you, do not compromise with these people. Why are you seeking the living among the dead? Why are you looking for Jesus in the dead religion? He's not there. He is risen. He is the I Am. Just like when He told the, you know, there's the Sadducees. As I said, they don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's why they're Sadducee. And they came to Jesus and they said, well, according to the law of Moses, you know, they tried to trick Jesus. You know, there's a man who had a wife and the man died without producing an heir. Okay, so according to the law of Moses, one of his brothers is supposed to take her as a second wife or whatever, you know, and sleep with this woman and then have and raise up children for his brother. If he has a child with his sister-in-law, that child is not his, but is really, you know, by the law, is the son of his brother. This guy, the new child, the son, would take the place of his brother and be the heir of his brother's share of their family's land and Israel and their inheritance. That's what he's doing. Because women were not allowed to have property, only the men. So this one, you know, his sister-in-law's a widow with no children. So the brother has to take the place and produce an heir for his brother so that that family would be perpetuated. Anyway, so the Sadducees said to Jesus, okay, then the second brother dies without producing an heir, and so on, till all seven brothers were dead, and then the woman never had any children. So their question was, is, you know, if he'd had his child with a, you know, she was like married to all seven of them, and but yet had a child with none of them. So when she's in heaven, whose wife will she be? And then Jesus said, you are due heir in the scripture. Because, you know, people in heaven are like the angels in heaven. They neither either marry or given in marriage. But then you read in the scripture what God said, I am. This people love to look at that other part. You know, talking about not being married in heaven and all that. But they miss what Jesus is saying there too. It's the most important thing. Jesus said, did you read in the scripture where God said to Moses from the burning bush, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So therefore, God is the God of the living and not the dead. So God didn't say, I was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But He says, I am, meaning right now in the moment. So it's not about God, even though God's eternal. It's not about what God's going to do tomorrow or what God's did yesterday. But He's the I am right now, today, in this moment. He is with us. God is with us right now, today. His Spirit has penetrated this, you know, the space-time continuum where we live, the fourth dimension. Here we are living in a three-dimensional world, passing through the fourth dimension of space-time. God is in this moment with us, though He is eternal, from everlasting to everlasting. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He's the all the highest dimensions and hyper-dimensions, whatever you want to talk about it scientifically and all that science fiction, whatever. God is all of that and a bag of chips, as they used to say when I was in the Army. He's all that and more beyond what we can ask or think or understand. But He's right here with us in the moment. And that's why the Lord wants me to ask you who are bound by false religion, who are bound in all this dead religion, why do you seek the living among the dead? The Lord is not there. He is risen. He is I am. He is with you. He's with me. You know, there's this old very, you know, the ultimate in religion probably, besides some cults like Jehovah's Witnesses or something like that. The ultimate in religion and Christendom, when I say Christendom, I didn't say Christianity, but Christendom, the greater kingdom of Christianity, which I guess you could probably include Mormons and stuff like that in there, whatever. And the greater Christendom, the greatest example of all this religion, has got to be Roman Catholicism. And it, of course, is the largest group. As I said to someone who is a big-time Roman Catholic, I said to this person, quoted from the Bible, where Jesus said, in Matthew chapter 18 or 19, he says, where two or more of you are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of you. That's the ecclesia. That's the church. That's the called out one. That's the saints. This person laughed. This person laughed in their comments to me, saying, you're saying that when two people are together, it's the church? No, that's what Jesus said. And that's the problem with this dead religion. They think people don't, you know, when I started these, back in the States, brothers and sisters, I started three or four churches. Three that, you know, the Lord used me, and then I helped start two more, I think it is. Yeah, at least. So at least five churches. Three that I did, me and the Lord only, and then two others I helped other people. Anyway, brothers and sisters, in every one of those churches we started as Bible studies and prayer meetings. And every one of those groups, there's always at least one or two people would ask me and said, you know what, we had it on Friday night. One of them was on Friday night, one was on Saturday night, one was Sunday afternoon. They're like, in every group, someone would say, well, we're meeting at 2 o'clock Sunday afternoon. But I know the Lord wants me to go to church. I need to find some place to go Sunday morning. Or for some of you Judaizers who are trying to follow the law, oh, I got to find a place to go Friday night or Saturday because I'm trying to be under the law and I want to go on the Sabbath. From the Old Testament. Every day is a celebration of the resurrection of the Lord. Every morning when you wake up, say, hey, this is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. You know, the Lord has made every day. Every day is holy to the Lord. Not just a special day. That's the difference between the law and grace. Under the law, it's like I punch my card. I give 10%. Boom. Click. I don't kill my neighbor. Click. I observe the Sabbath. Click. Where Jesus said, those who look upon a woman with lust have committed sin in their hearts. The New Testament says God loves a cheerful giver. It's not about giving 10%. It's about being a cheerful giver. The thoughts and intents of your heart. So the Sabbath, it's about your honoring the Lord, not just not doing any extra labor and sitting around and maybe reading a couple Bible verses and going to a gathering of people at a building. As a matter of fact, as they say, as it's really said, that's not really a church. It's a club. It's a lodge. The denominations are really a lodge or a club or some kind of an organization. It's not the church. We, born-again Christians, we are the temple of God. We are the ecclesia, the called out ones, the separated ones, the saints of God. Each individual, we together, all true born-again Christians, we together are the universal body of Christ. Now there are manifestations where two or more are gathered in my name. Me and you get together, the two of us, we sit down and pray, Lord, we love you, we thank you, sing a hymn to the Lord, praise the Lord, talk about Jesus. Hey, we're having church. That's church by Jesus' definition. Where two or more of you are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of you. That's a local manifestation of the church universal. And it does not have to be in a building. It does not have to have a banner over the door. That's where the 50 shades of gray comes in, when the organization comes in and all this. Oh, you got to have, you know, I've done lots of videos about this. God started a move through an individual or a group of individuals. Next thing you know, the terrorists come in. Oh, you got to have a master's degree to preach in our church, like the Methodists. Even Assemblies of God, they want you to have a master's or PhD to, you know, to be a pastor of one of their bigger churches. And all of this organization, it goes higher and higher and higher. All this man-made wisdom to the point where it's just, you know, we're high theologians. That is the dead. And as Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Come out from among them, ye people, and be holy, for I am holy. Come out from among them. Why are you seeking the living Christ, the great I am, amongst the dead? If God be for you, who can be against you? Don't worry. This, I made a video the other day, and the Lord gave me that name, the Lord of Sabaoth. Go look it up. He's the captain of the host of the Lord's army. The Lord of Sabaoth is who? The Lord of Hosts, it says there in the Old Testament, the translation is the Lord of Hosts, and the New Testament is properly translated in Romans chapter 9, James chapter 5, Lord of Sabaoth. He is the Lord of Hosts. He is with you. If God be for you, who can be against you? Just like, you know, you've got to be bold to stand up. For the Lord is a captain of our soul. He is the captain of our destiny. He is the leader of his army. You have got to be bold and stand up in these last days, because during the tribulation, the day is coming when it's going to cost people their lives. Right now in China or in Saudi Arabia, these places, it costs people their lives. Pakistan and all these places, it cost people their lives to stand up for Jesus. And here we are in America, and there's Christians being killed in the Philippines. Thank the Lord it's not been that many. Not like, you know, it's not a free-for-all like this Pakistan and all these other countries. But Christians die every day for the name of Jesus. And there, 90% of the people who watch my videos are English-speaking countries. U.S., Australia, New Zealand, Europe, all these places where, you know, it's just soft, soft, soft. Thousand shades of gray, arguing and debating over these little points, standing against the Word of God. Just as I mentioned that someone, you know, is laughing and mocking that two or more are gathered in my name and Jesus in the midst of us, and that's the church. Mocking that in that religious spirit, particularly that idol-worshipping spirit of popery from Rome. Mocking the true church. You got to stand boldly and not compromise with those spirits. We must rise up as the army of the living God. And that's what God wants to, use us not to, you know, to keep talking about the negative, accentuating the negative, giving the bad news of what's on TV. As I've said many times, there's lots of people on YouTube that love to proclaim the bad news. Guess what? The rapture's coming tomorrow. The whole world's going to hell. Proclaiming the bad news. Instead of the good news that Jesus is the Lord of Sabaoth, and if God be for you, who can be against you? Stand up boldly. Don't pay no attention to those relatives of yours. All, you know, all those people I've tried to minister to who are hell-bent, whiskey-bent and hell-bound, full of the devil. Lots of them, especially in America, claiming to be Christians. They're nominal Christians. They're not saved. They're full of mockery, and they are full of new wine and mockeries and blasphemies. And God is the judge. And that's why, brothers and sisters, we have to proclaim the truth and let the truth be a record. Let it be known. Let it be heard. Let it be known and reported that the word has gone forth, that the judgment of the Lord is even at the door of the church. For judgment begins at the house of the Lord, as Peter quoted to us from the Old Testament. Judgment begins at the house of the Lord. May you be found solid in Christ this day. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead and Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be called up together to meet them in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. And the spiritually dead will be left behind, cast into a bed of tribulation. For the judgment of the Lord is already laid at the root of the tree. So don't say, oh, I'm a member of the Pope said I'm good to go. I'm a member of the Baptist, First Baptist Church of so-and-so. I'm the member of Assemblies of God of so-and-so. The Lord is able to raise up from rocks to children to praise his name. Don't think because you are a child of Abraham or you're a member of a church that you are going to heaven, because God is able to raise up from rocks children to praise him. As a matter of fact, Jesus said, if the people would be silent, even the rocks would cry out and say, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Think not that your righteousness is of a religion or of a church or of a doctrine or of a creed, because the righteousness is of the Lord God Almighty. By grace are we saved through faith. Faith in what? Faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the righteousness is of me, says the Lord. Isaiah 55:17, as the Lord tells us in his word, the righteousness is of him. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Every word, every tongue that rises up against you, thou shalt condemn. This is the inheritance of the saints of God, and their righteousness is of me, says the Lord. Isaiah 55:17. For the Lord of Sabaoth will lead his army and defend his people, not by might or by power, but by his spirit, for the Lord himself is about to descend from heaven with a shout. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, and 18. He's about to rapture his true church, those virgins who are not asleep, but are awake and are ready and redeemed and looking up and packed up and prayed up, ready to go up and meet the Lord in the air, who's ready to answer the call of the bridegroom. They don't need to go buy oil. They don't need to go read their Bible. They don't need to find out what John Hagee has to say about it, or P.P. Simmons, or Paul Begley. They don't need to find out what no man has to say about it. They already know the risen Lord Jesus Christ. They already know the Savior. They know the I am that I am. They know that God is with them. They don't need any confirmation from any man, any woman, any church, any denomination, for they're in Christ. The Lord is coming for his own. The Lord is coming for his own. My sheep know my voice, he said. And the answer not to another. So when the Lord himself descends from heaven with a shout and he says, come up here, his sheep will know his voice and his sheep will answer him and not answer to another. But those who are not his sheep, who are among us, those sleeping virgins, those false converts, those tares are about to be left behind and about to be exposed. So I asked you who's watching this video, pray ye always, Jesus said. The command of the Lord Jesus Christ, Luke chapter 21, verse 36. Pray ye always that you be counted worthy to escape this coming tribulation period, these things that are about to happen, and stand before the Son of Man. Pray that you be counted worthy. I pray that you're found in Christ today. Repent today, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Delay not. Delay not your repentance. Today is the day. The Lord will not always strive with people. Don't believe all them lies that you're hearing from these greasy grace denominations. When I say greasy grace, I'm talking about churches that say you can say a prayer when you're 8 years old and then live for the devil the rest of your life, even denying the Lord, and that you're going to go to heaven by force. The Lord's going to drag you kicking and screaming into heaven because you said a prayer when you're 8 years old. They will tell you that, oh yeah, don't worry about it. Oh yeah. No, 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 no. They're just tickling your ears. Don't listen to those people. The Bible tells over and over again through the prophets of people that says there will be no destruction when God says, yes, there will be destruction. You don't listen to those false prophets. They have a lying spirit in them. Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 7. They have a lying spirit of divination in them. Do not listen to those voices. Listen to the voice of the Lord your God if you're one of his sheep. His sheep know his voice, and the answer not to another one. Read your Bible, the New Testament, from cover to cover. Read it over and over and over again until you know that you know. You don't need to ask anybody. Romans chapter 8, verse 16, for his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. You don't have to ask somebody, hey, am I saved? How do I know if I'm saved? What does the Bible tell you? What did God say? His spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child. Can't nobody tell you you're saved? Can't nobody tell you that, I'm not sure if you're saved. They don't know. It's you need to know. You and the Lord need to know. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Wrestle with God till you know. Get in there. Get in the ring with the Spirit of God. And don't let up until you know, like Jacob. Don't let up till the Lord blesses you and changes your name. Changes your last name to Christ. Those of you who want to be Judaizers, you don't need your name changed from Jacob to Israel. You need your name changed from whatever it is to Son of God, to child, to the last name Christ, that you belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, that you're his bride. The Lord is just reminding me of something else because I'm still going with it, brothers and sisters. I mentioned this a long time ago. The Lord gave me a revelation, a word a long time ago. It's just come back into my spirit. I bet it's been since 2003, 2004. It's been a good 10 years ago. And the Lord spoke to me and said that when somebody gets married, no matter what these these women who are trying to be men and the devil's using them, feminism and all this to overthrow God's authority that he set in the family as a representative of his authority in the church, as Christ is the head of the church. The man is supposed to be the head of his home. When you get married, the bride takes the name of the husband. So if you want to find out if your church, here's a test for you from the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Lord just reminded me of it, that he gave this to me 10 years ago. You want to find out if the people you know or your church and all that, you want to find out if they're Christians or not, you ask them, what are you? You know, and if they say, you know, our last name's Baptist, our last name is Catholic, our last name is Presbyterian, then who ever heard of a bride with her own last name? Some kind of hyphenated, you know, Hillary Rodham Clinton. It's not supposed to be that way. It's supposed to be, you know, Christ, last name Christ. The bride takes the name of the groom. So when you ask somebody, what are you? Oh, I'm a Christian. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm part of the bride of Christ. I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm a Christian, which means follower of Jesus Christ, a disciple of Jesus Christ. Someone tells you, oh, I'm a Baptist. Oh, okay, you're not a follower of Jesus. You don't take the name of your head of your group. The head of our group is Jesus Christ. So therefore, as the bride, we take the name of the husband, the bridegroom, Jesus. So, you know, I'm a Christian. I'm part of the body of Christ. Oh, you? Oh, you're a Baptist. Oh, you're a Methodist. Okay. You're like a, you know, you got that Jezebel spirit, you know, manifested as a feminist. You know, you're usurping the authority of the bridegroom and using your own last name. That's how you test whether the denomination be in Christ or not. If they're followers of Christ, taking the last name of the bridegroom, or if they're taking their own last name. Sometimes a hyphenated one. They're kind of lukewarm. You know, that's a Laodicean church. There's always that compromise. Well, you know, I say I'm a Baptist and a Christian. Oh, okay. So you're like Hillary Rodham Clinton. Not Hillary Clinton, but Hillary Rodham. So you just compromise there. Another one of the thousand shades of gray of the devil. God bless you guys. I came on here to make an announcement about going to the U.S. And if you're still watching this video and you can listen to me, then praise God. You obviously, you know, are receiving what I'm saying. So God bless you guys. You know what I'm saying when I'm talking by the Spirit of God. I become a different person. When I was in the States, you know, I had two or three people telling me that when they met me in person, I'm kind of quiet and all that, and I'm kind of different than when I'm preaching. That's true. I don't like to speak in front of crowds. I'm actually, you know, a private person and a quiet person. It's only that God compels me to preach. Woe is me if I don't preach the gospel, as Apostle Paul said. I'm not mad. I'm not angry. I'm not ranting. I'm not having any trouble. This house has been cleared by the blood of Jesus. I asked you guys to pray because I wanted some more backing to make a quick work of cleaning out this house, of the strongholds over this house, as I made a video. And then, of course, some people have, you know, in their minds are using it as an occasion to, you know, be spooky spiritual. You know, there's all those people that are spooky spiritual. They think everything is, you know, either, you know, spirit and all this kind of stuff. This house has been cleared. And this whole situation, just like when Joshua, my stepson, died in August 26, 2012, the harder something comes at me, the more I fight back. If it's something that's not, it's just a little thing, that I usually get bothered by the little things. Like my neighbors doing construction every day for a month and banging hammers, that bothers me. But big things, I'm ready to go for the fight. I'm ready to fight the good fight of faith and press in. So this situation where we had this haunted house that we moved into, it's been cleared out, number one. Number two, I'm closer to the Lord than I've ever been. It compels me to press in close to the Lord, to make a show of the enemy openly, to triumph over him in public. It's, you know, what I was born to do, to triumph in Christ over all the works of the enemy. So this is just another opportunity to make a chump out of the devil. So thank the Lord Jesus Christ that we overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So I testify that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, it says, of things in heaven, things on the earth, and under the earth, even the devil, demons, all that, and every tongue shall confess. That's angels, demons, humans, the lost, the saved, every tongue shall confess, and every knee shall bow that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So those spirits that were in this house had to bow to the name of Jesus. Praise God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, it's all cleared out. Thank you guys for your prayers. I didn't mention it before. I was just, you know, making sure, waiting and watching that it was all clear. Everything's all clear. I really appreciate all the prayers of the saints. That's what the body's about. That's, you know, my return from the YouTube ministry. The work I put into YouTube, the return for me is you guys praying for me to do the work here. I cannot do the work here. The work here, as I say, it's like walking in the ocean with an undertow up to water at the top of your nose. without intercessors. People are intercessing for you, the more and more and more, it pushes that current down to, you know, ankle level. And when it starts rising on me, that's when I ask for prayers, when I can feel that undertow current of the enemy, as the Bible says, the enemy comes in like a flood. God would raise up a standard against him. And, you know, you guys praying quickens that. That's why I thank you. Your prayers empowers me by God. God opens heaven more. He empowers me more. He sends more angels and all that thing for me to do the work here, to try to, you know, do the mission work in the Philippines and to make the YouTube videos. So I appreciate that. I'll be coming to the States. I've got requests to go all over the world, as I mentioned in a video I made on at Christmas time that I just loaded on YouTube just now, because I've been, you know, just loading other videos and I just now loaded it. I got, you know, requests to come all over the place, and I'm just praying about where to go in the States. I was looking to go to the East Coast. I got this wedding to do, and I don't know what's going on with that. I'm still waiting on the final date from, you know, it's just like the rapture. Waiting on the groom. We're waiting on the groom, just like the bridegroom. We're waiting on the bridegroom, waiting on the Lord. And so it's his family, just like the father would tell Jesus, okay, go get your bride for the rapture. Same thing here. I'm waiting on the parents of the groom to say, what's the date? They're still working it out because, you know, whatever. They're trying to get their family there and all this. Got family all over the U.S. to come. Anyway, so we're trying to get that worked out, and that's in the East Coast. But the Lord is really leading me, I think, to also go to the West Coast. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray about that. I'm being California. There's people that I'm going to see. I want to announce this, too, on the end of this video. I mentioned it before. We have an online church. The brother's made the website as much as he can. He's not able to finish it. He's got all these other things to do, and he's unable to finish the website. So I got a website that's about 90% complete. I'll put the name of the website below here. I'm asking Brother Martin, who handles the Joshua's Ministry website. He's very busy also. He, you know, he works full time. He's helping me with the, you know, the PayPal for Joshua's Ministry and all that. I don't think he has time to help us do the new website for the church. But anyway, this website, and I'll put the link down here. It's the churchoffirstborn.com. I'm not saying it exactly right. Churchoffirstborn.com, something like that. We want to have chat rooms. I want to have prayer. What I want to do, too, is I want to have people can put a prayer request, and then that prayer request will go out to people who are approved to be prayer warriors. You know, I don't want to, you know, if you put your prayer that is not to be public for the whole world to read it, maybe we need to talk about that if you want it to be public or not, or maybe you make it private. And it would just be emailed alert to those prayer warriors who would pray and read your prayer request, you know, and see your private, you know, prayer request. And then only those prayer warriors who've been pre-approved, intercessors, to pray over your situation. And then I know the Lord wants us to have elders in each region, people that want to be baptized, laid on to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, as I mentioned back when I was in South Carolina, Brother Sid, you know, the Lord told me Brother Sid had an idea that he wanted us to do. And then Brother Sid, when I met him, he gave me this idea that we would have elders in each region to baptize people, pray with people, visit the sick, whatever, for the ministry. So that's going to be part of it too, you know, each area, like an elder in Dallas, Texas, an elder in Houston, Texas, whatever, who would be available to baptize people, pray with people, lay hands on them to be healed, whatever, all this kind of stuff, by the grace of God. So I want to do that. That's a whole, so I what I'm asking is if people who know how to do websites, who we've communicated, and if we've never communicated before, I'd like to talk to you first and get to know you before I would, you know, let you get on the website and start doing it, as you can understand. I want to get it done, you know, by somebody who's really a Christian. And, you know, if I already know you, that's a bonus, right? Let's get it worked out, get it done. You know, by the grace of God, I know the Lord is pressing me to get it going and get it online, the Church of the Firstborn. We can do all those things. And I ask for your ideas. Any of you guys who say, hey, I would like to manage the area of a forum about the rapture. Okay, great. By the grace of God, you know, my answer is yes, unless I hear otherwise from the Lord, or you're doing, you know, some crazy stuff on there. If you want to manage a forum about the rapture, if you want to manage a forum about, you know, talking about what's going on in Israel and all this, we can have all these different forums and make threads on there and do all kinds of cool stuff. And then, like I said, a whole, you know, prayer warrior thing and a list of elders and contacts near people. Like, we can have a list of people, and then someone can email a person off that list and you live 2 or 3 hours away. We can meet halfway, and I want to talk to you about getting saved or whatever. We can do it, brothers and sisters. Let's go forward. Let's go forward. Let's do the work of the Lord. People stop taking, you know, the word of the Lord personally. You take it to heart. If it applies to you, repent of it. If you don't reply to you and you don't think it's right, you know, just go on. You know, there's lots of people that keep, you know, they're wearing their heart on their sleeve. They're taking everything, you know. Like when I preach, it's not personal. I'm not thinking about anybody. It's nothing personal. I'm laying out what is the Holy Spirit is leading me to say. You know, it's not personal. This is the business of the Lord. All of this is. Let's do the Lord's work. Let's go forward and let's be mature Christians and let's do the work. Let's win these lost. Let's pray for the sick. Let's see signs and wonders. I want to see, praise reports. I like to have videos of praise reports. You like you, Brother Sid in South Carolina, you can go pray with someone and then they got healed and then we post a video of it. Brother Brian down there in Katy, you know, we can post those videos on the website of praying for somebody that got healed and their testimony and people got saved, baptized in the Holy Spirit, et cetera, et cetera. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's be a salt and light out there. Let's stop getting all the speculation and slanderous comments against the politicians and all that. And that's not what a church is called to do. A church is called to preach holiness and righteousness and salvation and signs and wonders to follow us. Let's go do it.